Okay, so this is the third and last wrap-up video of Google I/O. And I want to go through three things that are all sort of geared at developers. Rather than Google's proprietary models like Gemini, which I covered in the first video, or their whole strategy around agents, which I covered in the second video, in this video, I want to cover stuff that you can use more that they talked about there. So the three things I'm going to talk about is, first off, the new TPUs, which I'll talk about briefly, but I do think they're important. But the second thing is the new Gemma models, which I think are really interesting. And then lastly, I'll talk about some of the things that are coming to Firebase and perhaps how they're opening up some of the ecosystem for languages like JavaScript, TypeScript, and even taking on some of the Vercel AI kind of things there. So the first thing I want to talk about is the new TPUs. So the new TPUs were announced. It's called Trillium. This is the sixth generation TPUs now. For those of you who don't know, the first generation was for inference only, and then each generation basically has been training, although the TPU5s had a version that specialized in inference as well. Okay, why is this important and what does this actually mean? First off, you should understand that the Gemini Ultra model, which is the biggest Gemini model, was actually trained on TPU4s, right? And it took a bit over 3 months, apparently, to do the training there. We know that the TPU5s were about 2.7, 2.8 times faster, I think, from memory than the TPU4s. So you could imagine that's made training a model on the size of that Ultra model go from 3 months down to a bit over a month. Now, with the announcement of the sixes, they're basically saying that these are up to, not always perhaps, but up to 4.7 times faster than the TPU5s. So this is insane that just in the space of a year, we've gone from having the largest Gemini model that Google's got, taking over 3 months to train, to now where they probably could train something similar in about a week or under. So that's a huge change in things. And I think we're seeing this across the industry. If we look at the new GPT-4o model, clearly, that is like a whole new trained model, not just a sort of fine-tuned version of GPT-4. The fact that it's got a new tokenizer, etc., that's a big deal. But while everyone is scrambling for compute out there and scrambling for their NVIDIA GPUs, Google is able to just make these TPUs. And because they make them themselves, they're not buying them from anyone. Really, you can imagine these things are not costing them anywhere near the cost of what people are paying for NVIDIA GPUs here. I do think this is a pretty amazing breakthrough that we're seeing here, is that this compute is just getting faster and faster, which is going to allow for bigger models and basically training for a lot more tokens, etc., as you go through here. So I'll leave it for you to go through the article and read this, but I think this is one thing that a lot of people have just overlooked totally that came out of the I/O announcements. So the whole purpose of including the TPU stuff in here is I kind of feel that developers need to be getting prepared for being able to do fine tunes on TPUs. So Google announced already they're going to make these TPUs available to people at the end of the year. And I think in the fine pricing wise, this is going to be really reasonable compared to training on GPUs. So you probably will be able to take some of these models like a Gemma 2 and fine tune it quite cheaply. Perhaps not totally easy, but quite cheaply going forward for this. The second thing that I wanted to jump in and talk about is the new Gemma models. First off is Pali Gemma. So basically where they're combining a Gemma model with this Siglip Vision model in here. So this is actually being used in other VLMs out there. And so it seems like what they've done is basically just take this, do their own sort of fine tuning and putting it together. And what I've been hearing from people, and I think I'll probably do a whole video just around Pali Gemma and talking about how to fine tune it, etc. But what I've been hearing from people is that people are getting this to do all sorts of tasks that they can fine tune pretty easily because the thing is so small. We're talking about something that's like under a 3 billion parameter model here. So it really is something that you can run without a lot of compute to do this kind of thing. You can fine tune it yourself for various tasks. And I think Google's already set this up to work easily for doing things like, you know, object detection and segmentation by using natural language to help. Like I said, this probably deserves a whole video by itself. We can look at that in the future. The other big news with Gemma was the announcement that Gemma 2 is coming in a few weeks from now. So this model is actually a much bigger Gemma model. So in the past, we've had like the 8 billion parameter model. We've had a 2 billion parameter model. We've had the recurrent Gemma, a code Gemma, which was a fine tune for doing code things. But we've been missing a bigger version than something that's above 10 billion parameters. And so sure enough, they've announced that they're actually going to release Gemma 2. Now, I'm not sure if this is going to be one model or a family of models, but at least one version of Gemma 2 is going to actually be 27 billion parameters in here. So this is certainly going to be a much bigger model than what most people can run. But you can imagine there's going to be quantized versions of this. And actually a 27 billion parameter model that's quantized down to 4-bit, I think a lot of people will actually be able to run this in a Llama and various quantized different versions of. They're also claiming that this model basically delivers performance comparable with the Llama 3 70 billion. That would be awesome if that works out to be the case for most things that people want to do with this. It's really going to open up the ability to do lots of fine tunings. Now, Gemma has a really good tokenizer for doing multilingual stuff. I've talked about this before. Google actually showed off in the keynote that some people are actually starting to fine tune the first versions of Gemma for multilingual use cases. My guess is that we will see that happen even more with Gemma 2. And I'm hoping that when we see the amount of tokens that this is actually being trained on, etc., that maybe a decent chunk of those tokens will actually be multilingual tokens themselves. So this model may end up being really good for doing any kind of multilingual task, as well as being able to fine tune for a variety of different tasks. So the last thing that I wanted to talk about is the Firebase Gen Kit. As I understand it, this is basically the Firebase team have been working on creating a JavaScript, or I actually think it's TypeScript, which surely has got to make it one of the first TypeScript products from Google. Google generally hasn't been a big user of TypeScript in the past. But the whole idea is that as people are starting to make generative AI apps using things like Next.js, etc., they want to actually be able to use APIs straight from the JavaScript/TypeScript interface. And the idea is that up until now, I guess we've had LaCelle has made some things around this, but Google's sort of stepping in and interestingly supporting Next.js with this, and also adding in quite a bit of support, I think, for Next.js with Firebase as well in here. The idea here is that you'll be able to run and ping many different models with the same kind of interface, be able to put that into your code and be able to do everything from things like Gemini Pro to Llama to a variety of different kind of models that they've got in here, both from Vertex AI and I guess from AI Studio as well in here. Now, they do say that it's an open source framework. I'm not sure how open. Are they going to allow people to add in the OpenAI SDKs and stuff like that? That I'm not sure about. I guess I'd be surprised if that was the case. But this does sort of give you a lot of tools that you can get started with for doing both LLM stuff and multimodal stuff like generating images, using some of Google's image generation, video generation SDKs that are slowly being made available to people. The other interesting thing is here is that they've made a local GenKit developer UI for you to try things out and experiment. So this looks very similar to AI Studio here, but I guess this, you know, allows you to sort of try different things out, try different prompts, different models, see what you get out of this, and then be able to just incorporate it straight into your app going forward in here. Another thing is that they talk about the whole sort of idea of flows and being able to track these. This is an interesting thing where perhaps they're taking on some of the functionality of something like a Langsmith or something and allowing you to basically do this yourself, rather than having to use, you know, an external service for doing this. So it's a new sort of project or framework that from Google. It's actually like from the Firebase team. And it does bridge the gap that Firebase had of where you either had to decide to go fully GCP cloud or if you wanted to use anything AI. So this allows you, I think, now to have sort of things like the Vertex AI for Firebase, which gives you access to the Gemini API and other things easily in here. So if you're a JavaScript developer, I'd say definitely check this out and see what you can actually build with this, because it's going to be interesting to see how it goes. So overall, this is just three things that I felt like deserved to be put in a video. I will certainly cover the Gemma 2 a lot more when the model is actually available. I think we'll do another video looking at the Pali Gemma and perhaps looking at fine-tuning that. But these are some of the things that you can start using to develop your own apps that Google made available here without having to use the Gemini APIs directly and stuff like that. So I kind of felt that a lot of these did get lost in the main announcements around I/O and deserved at least a small video looking at them. So anyway, as always, if you've got any comments, please put them in the comments below. Any questions, let me know. If you found the video useful, please click like and subscribe, and I will talk to you in the next video.